disease, also known as periodontal disease, has over 500 million people affected with it globally. As simple as it sounds, does it really have a great effect on us? Does it have any connections with mouth odor, which is also called halitosis, as this also has a high prevalence among us globally? How can we identify, treat, or prevent these conditions? We'll be looking at this week on Health Watch, and I am Precious David Ogaga. Please don't go anywhere. We will be right back. Did you know that gum disease is the leading cause of tooth loss in adults? Gum disease begins with plaque, a sticky, colorless film that constantly forms on teeth. Plaque contains bacteria. If not removed with daily brushing and flossing, plaque can build up. The bacteria in plaque releases toxins that reduces gum tissues. This condition is gum disease. If left untreated, gum disease can progress and lead to bleeding, tooth loss, and damage to bone and mouth tissues. The presence of gum disease is detected using a routine periodontal exam, which includes a gentle probing of the area between teeth and gum or gum pockets. The deeper the measurement, the more severe the infection. Healthy teeth and gums are indicated by a pocket depth of 1 to 3 millimeters, with no bleeding and sensitivity. Gum disease is present in over 75% of adult population and exists in various stages of severity. Gingivitis is the first stage. Gums are mildly inflamed, appears red and swollen, and may bleed during brushing. If detected early, it can be reversed. It has a pocket depth of 3 to 5 millimeters. Periodontitis is the second stage. Gums begin to move away from the teeth, allowing plaques, bacteria to move closer to tooth roots, supporting fibers and bones with pocket depth of 5 to 7 millimeters. The advanced periodontitis, supporting fibers and bones are destroyed, teeth becomes loose and may need to be removed by a dentist. It comes with a pocket depth of 8 to 9 millimeters or more. See your dentist if you experience any of these red or swollen gums, that is, gums that are red, swollen or tender. Bleeding gums, gums that bleed during brushing or flossing, gums that pull away, that is, gums that have moved away from the teeth, forming pockets. Changes in bite, that is, changing in the way teeth fit together when you bite. Bad breath, when there is a persistent bad breath or bad taste in your mouth, please see the dentist. But the good news is that gum disease is preventable. Everyday tooth brushing, using the right brush and toothpaste, flossing and visiting the dentist at least 2 times a year can prevent gum disease. Remember, taking care of your gum will make your teeth last a lifetime.
Thank you for staying with us. This is Health Watch, and today we'll be discussing gum disease. And I have to discuss this topic with me, Dr. Benga Awunwe. Thank you, Doctor, for giving us the privilege to speak with you on this topic.
So, the pleasure is mine.
To our viewers at home, some of them have heard about gum disease, but I'm not sure they know. So, in a layman's term, what would you say is gum disease, or how did they get to know what gum disease is all about?
Well, I have a model here. Maybe I'll just quickly point at that. That's the gum, the pinkish, reddish, in some cases mustard looking in color, that is shade or hue, flesh, okay, at the base of the teeth, and within and somewhat without, you know, that's on the front surface and on the back surface, on the lower end of the teeth, from the neck of the teeth down to the end of the roots. Of course, the roots are embedded in the bone, and though you don't see them, so covering that on the outermost part are what the gum, medically we call them the gingiva, but in simple English they are called the gum. And since you asked me about gum disease, it's just how do we define that? The gum are healthy and they are neat, they are attached, they are not swollen and all of that. But when you have gum disease, all the characteristics of the structure of the gum is the opposite. It becomes inflamed, becomes flabby, begins to pocket, oozes fluid, and so on, and of course begins to be tender.
Okay,
elicit pain.
It's like you're taking us a bit further because you're already telling how we can identify. So, what as a normal human being, when they give birth to you, the gum is normal here. So, what brings you to this part? So, what are the positive agents? Is it maybe a habit or?
Gum disease can be caused by several factors. The first thing is poor oral hygiene. If a person doesn't brush his teeth as at when due, which is supposed to be twice daily, morning and night, after meals, of course, then you are susceptible to gum disease because acquired pellicle, which eventually leads to calculus on the surface of the teeth, begin to irritate the gum. Yes, begin to irritate the gum. Bacteria is there. The bacteria feeds on food remnants in the body, and then there are products from that, and the products further irritate the gum. And before you know, the gum begin to react to that. So it reacts to that by getting swollen, reacts to that by bleeding. Because once the body notices that the condition therein is abnormal, blood factors ascended. And because it's swollen, any little touch tends to, tear, so to speak, the gum, and it begins to bleed. Because it's like a balloon. A balloon is an elastic material that has caused to be swollen by pumping air into it. So just put a pin and it bursts. So by the same token and principle, any little touch on the gum begins to elicit bleeding, elicit pain, and so on and so forth.
Okay, for a patient that hasn't visited a doctor, how do you get to understand that, okay, I have gum disease? Maybe is there something that I will see in the house, or when I look at the mirror, I'm like, okay, I have it, or I need to visit the doctor? So how do you, like I said, the symptoms now?
That's a solid question. For us as dentists, many a time we don't see our patients until they are in pain, sometimes super pain. They do all sorts at home, and when they can't bear any longer, they land in the dental clinic. So pain is one first thing that brings the dental patient to the clinic. So how does a patient know, going back to your question, that he has one gum disease or the other? Pain. He begins to notice that along his gum line, whatever the position is, he feels pain there, or he cannot chew. He begins to have problem with chewing. He cannot chew. He's got one gum disease or the other. Or he notices that there is a fluid oozing from certain areas of his gum. The odor from which may be offensive in certain cases. Okay. Another one is bleeding. Did I mention that? Bleeding. Yeah. When the gums begin to bleed. Okay. And of course, obvious inflammation, swelling. You see it. You look into a mirror and you notice that certain portions of your gum don't look normal. They appear more rotund, more engorged, swollen, okay, than other parts, other gum parts in the same mouth. Okay, those are the concerns that bring the patient, but chief amongst them is pain.
Okay, for every pain, it's advisable that for every pain you get to experience, you visit the dentist and just trying some antidotes. Just try and visit your dentist whenever you experience the pain. So going forward, doctor, we talked about what it is with positive agents. Are there any risk factors to an individual when you experience this?
Risk factor would be, by its very definition, what are those things that if you remove them, they will slow down the process of developing that condition. If you bring them in, they will hasten the process. Those are risk factors. What makes it happen faster? Okay, so in the case of gum disease, if the body is unhealthy, as so to speak, a condition where the entire system is not healthy, the patient can suffer gum disease. For instance, I won't say that is not healthy. When women are pregnant, that is what you call pregnancy gingivitis. If she doesn't take care, she may suffer pregnancy gingivitis, because when a woman is pregnant, the entire system, hormonally speaking, in the body goes haywire. A woman is a changed being entirely because she carries more body than she alone can bear. One child, one fetus, or more. And so the body rearranges itself in order to give life for 9 months
provide a condition that is suitable for that baby to thrive until it is born. That is not funny for the mother, and several parameters change. One of the things we see as dentists is that she has the tendency to have swollen gums. Now, there is the superimposed condition of having swollen gums in pregnant women, because everything just becomes like a burden. To brush for her becomes a burden in some cases, and therefore her oral hygiene is compromised, so that worsens it. That you will find in a normal person whose oral hygiene is also poor. Because she's pregnant, she probably used to brush 2 times daily. Now she brushes once, or she doesn't even remember to brush a day. Or even when she remembers, she just cannot pick up the toothbrush and do that. And she's home all day for whatever reason. She develop pregnancy gingivitis. So risk factors here, hormonal changes in the body. You take certain drugs, they can make the gums swell. Some people are simple as certain anti-malarials. Someone is reacting to it, and so certain drugs can cause the gums to swell and give gingivitis. But whatever the factors in the body that are physiological changes that cause the gum to swell, what is most important is oral hygiene. If there is superimposed poor oral hygiene, then it becomes a classic pathology. But if it's just gum swelling as a result of a physiological change, a natural change in the body, like pregnancy, yeah, like a drug that somebody has taken and the body is reacting to it, the gum swelling may be there, but there may not be obvious pain, bleeding, and the rest of it. But when you now put poor oral hygiene on top of that, then you see the symptoms that you will see in classic gum disease.
Okay, what you've said now, can this lead to its own form of oral, that one you guys call halitosis, right?
Halitosis.
Does it have any connection with
halitosis? Halitosis is a different ball game entirely. By itself, it's not a dental or medical condition.
Okay.
Halitosis is not a diagnosis. Okay. Halitosis can be a sign or a symptom, depending on who is discovering it first. Halitosis is the medical name for mouth odor. Mouth odor itself is a misnomer, because that you call it mouth odor does not mean that it is exactly emanating from the mouth. It might as well be coming from the lungs. It might as well be coming from the airway through the nose and all of that. But because it passes through the mouth, it is called mouth odor or bad breath. Those two can be misnomers. It just means that the breath is stale, it's objectionable, but it doesn't necessarily mean it's coming from the mouth. However, maybe 90% or more of the time, it's actually coming from the mouth. The mouth is number one culprit, and there are several criminals in there that may cause the mouth odor.
Okay, so basically, when you experience this thing, the best thing to do is just visit the dentist and get your...
Yes, before you start doing, sorry to cut you, before you start doing some home remedies, just visit your dentist. Or you may just need a simple S and P. That's what we call it, scaling and polishing. Okay, wherein the dirt, the capillaries formed on the surface of the teeth are either mechanically or electronically removed. Okay, and then the dental staff will give you instructions as to how to maintain optimal oral hygiene. And the condition will just naturally regress, whether you are pregnant and you have pregnancy gingivitis, or you are on certain medication and you are having reactionary swollen gingiva as a result of the medication you are taking, an adverse reaction to the medication you are taking. They will naturally regress. So far, your oral hygiene, which is the key there, is taken care of.
Okay. So as a dentist, how do we take this? What's the preventive measure? What's the treatment like?
You don't want to have gum disease. You want to shy away from halitosis and such oral problems. The first thing to do at home, you are yourself's first doctor. Just as you are yourself's first dentist, as the case is here. Fantastic oral hygiene, brushing day and night, every morning and every night, after meals, is instructive, is crucial that you brush after meals in the morning and after meals also at night. Then, second to that, is a routine visit to the dental clinic at least twice yearly, especially for routine checkup as well as scaling and polishing.
Okay. Doctor has given us a preventive measure from our user perspective. Then, as a doctor, if the person comes to your facility now, What are the treatment processes that person?
If a person comes and complains of mouth odor, like we said earlier on, halitosis, like we call it in medical dental practice, then we want to find out what is the cause. And then we have to rule out a lot of things because, like I said, mouth odor is a misnomer. Yeah. It may be coming from somewhere deep within the body. It may be coming from the gastrointestinal tract. It may be coming from the lungs in case of one lung infection or the other. Okay? Yeah. We want to find out what's causing it. When we find out what's causing it, solution to the problem may not even be situated in the dental clinic. That's one. So that we have to refer to the relevant specialty. Solution of the problem may also be something that has to be handled in an interdisciplinary fashion, in which case you need to involve other specialist physicians as well as yourself, the dentist, to co-manage the case. You do your part, they do theirs, and then it now takes two to tango to have fantastic oral hygiene. When the patient come and we have ruled out that this is a strictly oral thing, of course we go to solve the problem. Mouth odor can come because we have tooth decay. We nip that in the bud, we solve the tooth decay. If the tooth needs to be filled, we fill it. If it needs to be extracted outrightly, we extract it. Mouth odor can come because you just have simply poor oral hygiene. We give the patient oral hygiene instructions. Brush twice daily and don't forget your tongue. Okay, people brush their mouth, their teeth, but forget the tongue. The tongue is like a huge absorbent towel. If you dry your body after taking your bath every day with your towel and you don't sun it, it will smell. Even when you do, it is instructed that from time to time you wash that towel in soap or detergent and clean water. So when you brush, you might brush all you want. You might have fantastic dentition and you still have bad breath because your tongue has food remnants on its surface, especially what we call the posterior one third of the tongue, which is when you take the tongue and divide it into three portions. Okay, the last third in which is situated in the throat seems to harbor a lot of dirt and, of course, consequently, bacteria. And so, when you brush, you need to take your brush all the way back and brush those areas. Of course, it needs to be expertly done. It comes with practice and experience. Because when you go there is tendency to want to retch, to want to vomit. It stimulates your vomiting reflux. There is tendency for you to want to vomit if you have eaten before. Because now the dentist has advised that you eat before you brush.
Yeah.
You eat before you brush.
So you're already full.
So toothbrushing may appear dangerous, but it comes with practice to do it well and not vomit each time you eat. Because you need to brush your tongue, especially the posterior, the last one third that is situated in the throat.
Okay, basically the doctor has been speaking on gum disease and of course I asked him how it relates to mouth odor. And the key thing he has always said is that we should make sure we take our hygiene seriously. Whenever you feel the pain, no matter how small, instead of trying to fix it, just try and visit the dentist. You mustn't be afraid of the hospital every time. Just visit the dentist. Meet the professionals to be able to take care of you so that you know what to do and avoid the reoccurrence. So, doctor, on the final note, what would you advise on the general note, whether you have gum disease or you have mouth odor, what would you advise us to do? And if you have your
head? I'll take the issue of mouth odor very seriously. Why? Because it encompasses everything. In itself, it's not a diagnosis. It's not a disease condition. Mouth odor emanates as a result, comes by as a result of one condition in the body that may not even be related to the mouth. Yes, diabetics may have a kind of breath. Somebody that stops us, what we call a condition that we call, for instance, diabetic ketoacidosis, may have a particular kind of breath. Okay? Somebody that is diabetic again, especially with poor oral hygiene, may have gum disease. If he has gum disease, his gum may be oozing pus. When it has gotten to that stage, there will be odor in his mouth. No two about it. In addition to his underlying systemic diabetic condition, the diabetic condition has gone beyond being systemic and affecting everything in his body. It's also affecting his gum. So diabetes is important to several medical professions, including dentistry. Because with the presence of diabetes, the gums become weak, they ooze pus, they can't hold the teeth any longer. The periodontium, the entire bundle that hold the teeth in place and make them strong, including the alveolar bone that holds the teeth, are compromised, and the teeth begin to shake and pulse the sutura, and there's odor everywhere. So halitosis is related to all of them. If somebody has tooth decay, may have halitosis, mouth odor as a result of a decay tooth. Somebody has poor oral hygiene in that he doesn't brush his teeth and all that. May have mouth odor. May even have good oral hygiene, but his oral hygiene technique is poor in that he brushes all the teeth and all of that, but he forgets the tongue. Or he brushes the tongue, but forgets the portion in the throat. You see, all these things are interwoven. So somebody has a sore in the mouth, oral ulcers. The sore becomes super reinforced with infection. You know, a secondary infection on top of the sore begins to ooze pus, that mouth odor. If somebody has tonsillitis, these are in quote organs in the body that help deal with infection. Some of them, they are tonsils, they are situated in the base of the throat. If where they are infected, they can begin to ooze odor from the pus, purulent discharge, pus oozing from there. That can also give mouth odor. That is one thing that may need to be handled between the dentist and maybe the ENT surgeon and all of that. At least once a year, visit the dentist. Not just to check your teeth, the dentist's life, work, discipline, and profession goes beyond the teeth. The teeth are situated somewhere. That's why we spend 6 years in school like you spend studying medicine. We study a good portion of medicine and surgery. That's why we are called dental surgeons. You need to know about the entire body in all ramifications before you can deal with the teeth. Because the teeth don't hang in the mouth in isolation. They hang even in bone and are covered with flesh. So the dentist is a dental surgeon. So it's important that you know that he is a serious professional that you need, just like you need your pastor, you need your lawyer, okay, and so on and so forth. So visit your dentist once, at least once yearly. It should be twice yearly, as once yearly. Have scaling and polishing done, that's cleaning of your teeth, okay? And brush twice daily after meals. After meals, twice daily. I mean, it's instructive that we do that, and then we'll be the better for it.
Wow. A word is enough for the wise, according to the doctor. Please make sure you can visit your dentist. I thank you, Dr. Gbenga, for coming on the show, and I hope we'll get you some other time.
Thank you, sir. It's my pleasure to be here. Thanks for inviting me.
All right. Stay tuned. Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back. The doctor has said a lot this week on gum disease, and I hope you learned a lot of things, and make sure you put this into practice. But most importantly, do well to follow a program of good oral hygiene. That means brushing at least twice daily correctly, flossing where applicable, and regular visit to a dentist shouldn't be ruled out at all, at least twice a year. And don't forget, I am Precious David Ugaga, but you are your first doctor. Keep a date with us on Healthwatch, because it's always about your total well-being.